This week on the Mr. Throwback Thursday podcast, we bring you hip hop establishments, a quick reunion, Bill Murray brought to the yard, a new Cool Keith persona, and we sit down with the legendary MC GLOBE. What else? Let's listen.
It's not just any day. It's Mr. Throwback Thursday.
All you kids want to get on and shit.
You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
No, I'll be dead.
At the count of three, I want you all to tell me the name of my DJ. 1, 2, 3.
Poppers, poppin', the breakers break. Like the fellas say, oh, and the girls say, hey. Give it up for the DJ, Mr. Throwback Thursday.
And now, here's your hosts, Bill Winters. And Mr. Throwback Thursday himself, Jamie Robinson.
Once again, it is about that time, Mr. Throwback Thursday coming at you. Episode 489 with your two favorite hip hop idiots. One is up in New York. One is up in Virginia. And you may, if you're on this live feed, be able to tell who is who. Bill is up in New York. I have New York on my hat. Jamie is in Virginia. He has Virginia on his hat.
I do.
Welcome to Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 489. How are you doing, my friend?
I am well. I am well. Had an interesting conversation yesterday, and I'm hoping that we can continue that conversation today.
That is the plan. Yes.
Yeah. And no, all is well. I made a few bucks on some MMA fights last night.
Very nice. I didn't bet those things
because I lost a bunch of money on some baseball yesterday.
Yeah. I am one Vegas Golden Knight win away from winning on my Stanley Cup bet.
Nice.
So we shall see. Yeah. I mean, it wasn't huge. I mean, Vegas was one of the prohibitive favorites, but
right.
You know, you put $5 down, you win $25 on
that's
it.
That's a deal.
Yeah, it's not bad.
That is what a bargain for you. Yeah, that's like my Denver Nuggets one. I got them at plus 800.
Wow.
It was,
when did you make that bet?
Right after. Okay, so I had $10 on the Bucks to win from like midseason. The second the Bucks got knocked out of the playoffs. Well,
right in Denver.
Right before they got knocked out, I withdrew my bet. I cashed out my $10 at $10.
Oh, but you're lucky they gave you all 10.
Yeah. And then I took 5 and put it on Denver at plus 800.
Put 5 on it.
I did. And if I could
get more,
that was quicker.
I got 5 on it.
That's my my betting unit.
That's pretty much my betting unit too. And I say that every time I place one. I got 5 on it. I'm such an idiot that way though. No, never more. 5 is enough.
Yeah. Oh, I bet 50 one time unintentionally.
I know, and you're lucky you hit it.
I know. I about had a heart attack.
Because you sent it to me. You're like, look what this bullshit I did was. I was like, was that intentional? And you went, no.
No, it is.
No, not at all.
Coming out of my pocket, a $50 bet is never intentional.
unless you're gonna bet that every day has 24 hours in it.
Yeah. I will not bet on the 72 Dolphins to go undefeated. Knowing the 72 Dolphins went undefeated, betting $50, they would still get 5.
They got 5 on it.
Ray so, Finkel.
We are jam-packed for today, are we not?
We try to be.
We've got some hip-hop headlines.
That's good.
Including some ridiculous stories this week.
You know, ridiculous stories often happen. I just don't always bring them to the yard.
Yeah, but nice. Nice segue there, and we're going to get to that in a second. I'm sure everybody already knows about that because everybody probably had a collective, when they read it the first time. But we're going to talk about it.
Yeah, she slammed
it. Hear it? Here it goes. We are scheduled to have a special presentation.
We are.
If for one reason or another that does not happen, we do have some Woo News as backup.
Yes.
We have a couple of records that depending on how long the special presentation runs, we may get to, we may not get to. Good morning, Manny from 37,000 feet.
I think that's the first time anyone has listened to us that high physically. I am quite sure we've been listening to that high mentally.
In other ways, yes. 37,000 feet. Brother got high.
I'm going to guess he's not mountain climbing. I'm going to say he's probably flying, but you never know.
I would think so. Well, either way, it's always a pleasure to see Manny.
Yes, yes.
Is he in the Mile High TBT Show Club now? He's in the 6 miles high. Yeah, miles high. 5,280 feet.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, he's in something. Mathing. Math. I'm good at the maths, as Nipsey's Country would say. I don't know why they put an S on it, but that's probably because of mathematics.
Sure. DJ Mathematics.
He's we've talked about him. and full circle.
Of course.
And again, based on how long the special presentation goes, possibility of records. We have a one and done. We have a record of the week. We'll remind you who the artist of the month is. If we don't get to it, it's Rappin' Forte. So yeah. Go check him out.
And we will, no matter what, do Bill Reed's lyrics.
Yes, because that's a staple. And then we'll put a bow on it. So shall we? We shall.
Surely.
If you would be so kind. Please hit me up with a little of that Triple H.
Yay, yay.
This is Hip Hop Headlines, brought to you by Mr. Throwback Thursday.
Well, get on it. It's your time.
My toin starts with an edict from you. You have titled this, Support Hip Hop.
Yes.
I felt very intimidated when I read time. I was like, I've been trying to do that every week for 9 years. I don't know why he thinks I'm not now.
I am just reinforcing
the message. I bought the mugs, which, by the way, are available for a discounted price on MrThrowbackThursday.com now.
Get them out of my house.
You get out of my... Get out.
Too bad they can't stay, baby.
Because I need to make the decade of dumbassery mug, and I cannot do that.
Okay. Apparently that's our theme. I like it. Wasn't consulted, but I like it.
It actually just came to me as I was speaking about it, so it may not be a thing. It's like the show.
No,
the title, you know what? May come to me later.
I don't think there's a more apt description. And what do I always say? Your two favorite dumbasses.
Exactly. Yeah, but these got to go.
As opposed to our jackassery, which is only completely. On Halloween.
That's Halloween, yes.
Which I saw that mug this morning, by the way. Did you? I almost grabbed it, and I was like, nah, it's not close enough to October. Halloween mug? The Halloweenus. So Support Hip Hop. This comes to us from NYCGo.com, which is the official guide to New York City.
It is.
It's more of a tourism website. Visit these New York City businesses with ties to hip hop.
Which makes me think Stefan should be doing this. New York's hottest club.
I can't do his voice, though.
No.
Only Bill Hader can do that. Bill Hader's
got that, yeah.
And Bill Hader can't do it without breaking every single time.
Which is why there is no Stefan movie. He said he's been approached to do it. He goes, the only thing people like is that I break. He goes, how do you write a movie about that?
Make it some kind of hip-hop music, pillar of New York City's culture since its origin in the South Bronx. The South Bronx.
Yes, yes.
In the 1970s, hundreds of notable hip hop artists have come from the five boroughs. Over the past five decades, there are businesses in New York City now that were founded by local musicians and lovers of hip hop culture that if you are ever in the Big Apple, say next year when you come to the Big Apple for the opening of the Universal Hip Hop Museum, there are other places you could check out. Places such as Cup. Coffee uplifts people. That is right up our alley.
We like coffee.
We are fans of coffee. One specific brand of coffee, I will say.
Yes.
But
it does reign supreme over nearly everybody.
It does. Coffee rules everything around me. Cream, not in the cup, yo.
No, no.
I drink it black, y'all.
It's CRS-1. Coffee reigns supreme over nearly everybody.
Coffee Uplifts People is a vibey coffee shop in Bed-Stuy, opened in 2020 by radio host and entertainment personality Angela Yee.
Yep.
And her two business partners, LaRon Batchelor and Tony Forte. Angela Yee, who until recently, he's the artist of the month.
He is.
Spelled the exact same way, though.
It is.
Just not with the number four, T-A-Y, his real name, Forte. No, it don't make anybody none. Angela Yee, who until recently co-hosted The Breakfast Club, which was a hip-hop-centric morning show, was motivated to open the cafe during the pandemic when she noticed a lack of coffee shops in her neighborhood. She was up to no good. Didn't have no coffee in the neighborhood. The contemporary decor and sparse seating make it a great place to work remotely or take a quick break from the pulsing streets of the neighborhood. The menu offers traditional breakfast pastries such as croissants and bagels, along with items from the many cultures around Brooklyn and sourced from nearby eateries, such as currant rolls. That's current, not as in not happening as in now, recent, but yes. Current with an A-N-T, as in black currant and other flavors, which come from Allen's Bakery, which I believe is just right down the street from them.
Oh, nice.
You can go check out Juices for Life, which has multiple locations. That's a good question, Cranky. That was a clue on Jeopardy this past week. I don't think Cronuts are still around.
I can tell you,
I haven't seen one.
If you go to Las Vegas and you go to the New York casino, which is a really cool casino because the whole thing off of the casino floor is like walking around New York. You know, you get your restaurants and whatnot, all like storefronts. There is a place there. You go in, it's on the left hand side and it's on the left again. I don't remember the name of it. Anyway, they have Cronuts there. Are they in the wild anymore? I do not know, but I do know that they serve it there. And that's because it was a big thing in New York.
Like Derek B, he had one of the hottest records in New York.
That's what I heard.
Anyway, that's something completely different. Juices for Life, in the mood to drink your greens and get that extra boost of nutrients, consider a visit to Juices for Life. Founded in the Bronx by Styles P and Jadakiss. Two members of the Lox. This shop now has locations in Brooklyn, co-owned by Angela Yee. Mm-hmm. So she got her finger in the vichyssoise. Her ladle is in a lot of it. So
I think I'll stay in Brooklyn.
No, because they also have locations in Queens and Yonkers.
Nice.
Where Jada and Styles P grew up.
I wonder if they serve Jada's coffee there.
It'd be silly if they don't.
Yeah.
Offering extensive list of smoothies, juices, and juice shots. Styles P used juicing to gain control of his own health journey, and he and Jada wanted to encourage those in less wealthy communities to engage more in their overall wellness. That is a very viable reason to open up that type of shop. So yeah.
Not just another McDonald's or 7-Eleven or whatever where you're just going to get shit food. Get the good stuff.
As opposed to shit hats. Yes. No shit hats today, by the way. We've gotten the cranky approval on the hats. Bistro. That's at 135 Alexander Avenue in Mott Haven, the Bronx. Mm-hmm. This uptown baby eatery pays homage to hip hop culture and transports patrons back to the streets of New York City during the 70s and 80s when hip hop was still on its ascent. Junior Martinez and Alfredo Anguier founded this Bronx restaurant, which they've styled with graffiti, murals, photographs of hip hop legends such as DJ K Slay, and paintings of tag New York subway trains from that early era. The menu has a mix of American soul food and Puerto Rican comfort dishes. We're talking shrimp and grits, pernil, crispy catfish, bacalao, and Maduro appetizers that will make you want an extra order to go.
I don't know what bacalao is, but now I want to try it.
Also in the Bronx is the Boogie Down Grind Cafe. That's a coffee shop. It is. The Boogie Down Grind is the go-to coffee shop in the South Bronx, the South Bronx. When you want to be fully immersed in hip-hop culture, South Bronx native Majora Carter founded this cafe to boost the surrounding Hunts Point community and highlight the local talent.
Did you say Kajana previous, Carter?
Majora Carter.
Okay.
Her previous aspiration to be a rapper and her general love for hip hop inspired the themes around the cafe, which was recognized by Beyonce with a Be Good grant for revitalization of the restaurant. Carter used the grant to create an outdoor space that replicates a New York City subway car. The design earned the cafe an Alfresco New York City Award. Live music and art pop-ups amplify the talent in the area and bring that community together. That sounds like a really cool place to check out.
It does.
Up NYC, 3806 Broadway, Harlem, Manhattan, 519 West 207th Street, Inwood, Manhattan, 2490 3rd Avenue, Mott Haven, the Bronx. Lots of locations.
Yes.
Head uptown to Up NYC, a sneaker and apparel store owned by Fat Joe.
Nice.
The company launched in 2016 with locations in Harlem, Inwood, and the Bronx, all of which display Joe's love of sneakers and sneaker culture. Up NYC quickly garnered widespread support from local communities by offering popular streetwear brands like Billionaire Boys Club, Bape, and Honor the Gift. Sneakerheads across the city come to grab the latest limited releases, and the fashion conscious arrive in search of the perfect pair of kicks to complete an outfit.
So you're searching for the perfect kicks.
Yes. Stay pressed. In Crown Heights, Brooklyn, at 679 Classen Avenue. Stay Pressed is a great grab-and-go spot in Crown Heights for juices, smoothies, and healthy fruit bowls. Co-founded by rapper Michi Darko, a former member of the Flatbush Zombies.
Okay, quiet.
Along with two longtime friends, the space is a small walk-in shop with fruit-inspired designs on one wall and an extensive menu covering the opposite one. If you're looking to stay a while, come for one of its Taco Thursday evenings, which typically take place in the warm weather months. Sweet Chick is your next. It has multiple locations. Sweet Chick has gained popularity across the city over the past 10 years by highlighting one of the most delicious brunch food combos, chicken and waffles.
Yes.
It is partially owned by Queens-born rapper Nas and serves up perfectly golden crispy fried chicken with an assortment of both sweet and savory Belgian waffles. Flavors include apple cinnamon, chocolate chip, vanilla glaze, and bacon cheddar. The menu offers other breakfast items such as pancakes, shrimp and grits, and breakfast sandwiches. The casual decor and lively atmosphere make it a great place for a quick and easy dinner or brunch with friends. Have you ever eaten chicken and waffles?
I have. Roger Brown's down in, you know, downtown Portsmouth here has good chicken and waffles.
I don't know if I've ever done chicken and waffles. It's one of the things that I really want to try, though.
Then you should do that.
Killer Coffee Shop in Staten Island. Go figure. Killer Coffee is one of the few black-owned businesses and the only one owned by a hip-hop artist on Staten Island.
Okay.
Toast Face Gorilla. Rapper and member of the Wu-Tang Clan opened the brick and mortar location in West Brighton after a year of successful online sales. The quaint coffee shop brews the finest Arabica coffee beans, has a small selection of store branded merchandise, and is a great stop for a quick hot brew to go while exploring many of the other sites on Staten Island.
And he is dropping a new blend or a new flavor. And I'm going to have to put my glasses on to read it. I should be wearing them all the time, but I take them off because the light messes with them. Yep. It's called Shaolin Cannoli.
Shaolin Cannoli?
Yes, it comes in a gold bag. It's just saw it last night that it was announced to be a thing.
Cool. Paint and Pour on Delancey Street in Lower East Side, Manhattan. And you know what I think of when I think of Delancey Street?
Dane to Dane?
Well, that and The Thing from the Fantastic Four. Although, no, he was on Yancey Street, wasn't he?
I would have to dig for that.
I think that was Yancey Street, now that I think about it. But immediately, The Thing popped in my head. But yeah. Now that's why. Because Delancey being close to Yancey, but I'm pretty sure it was Yancey Street.
Yes. No, I always think of Dane to Dane. Delancey Street. Delancey Street.
Cinderella Dana Day.
Yes, yes.
Head on over to Paint and Pour on the Lower East Side or in Harlem for a night of great music, because there's two locations, 53 Delancey Street, Manhattan, 2080 Frederick Douglass Boulevard in Harlem. It's a great night of music and a way to express your creativity. The spot is not your typical paint and sip experience. Guests are guided through painting their favorite hip hop artist while listening to hip hop hits and sipping specially crafted cocktails. The studio walls are covered in graffiti. Yes. The studio walls are covered in graffiti, not the words of the prophets.
Gotcha.
Because although we've been told the words of the prophets were written on the studio walls.
Yes.
If you listen to Rush. And the Harlem location features murals of legendary musicians such as Biggie and Beyonce. If all the painting makes you hungry, don't worry. There's a full food menu with items such as fish tacos, sliders, and jerk chicken empanadas.
All of it sounds good.
Bronx native on 127 Lincoln Avenue in the Bronx. Mm-hmm. This curated clothing and gift store was founded by Bronx natives Amaris and Rosalind Grulin. The siblings started by designing stylish apparel such as hats and t-shirts that represent the Bronx. When you step into the store, you are immersed in hip hop culture, specifically Bronx hip hop culture. Yes. The walls are covered in graffiti tags created by patrons as they come to shop. Yes, you can tag the walls when you go in there to shop.
That's kind of cool.
And photos of hip hop artists such as the Bronx's own. Absolutely. Because ain't nobody got a graffiti allergy. And photos of hip hop artists such as the Bronx's own. Big Pun.
Nice.
Choose from the large selection of tees, sweatshirts, caps, and accessories. Think throw pillows, mugs, and pins to show your love for the Bronx. So lots of cool places to check out.
Yeah.
So if you want to bookmark this, go to MrThrowbackThursday.com. Click on the show notes. You will see this article. Bookmark it. And when you come up to the city for the opening of the Universal Hip Hop Museum,
where we plan to
and
be,
you get your hotel room and all that.
And your motel room.
At the Holiday Inn. Indeed. So, you know, go check out some of these places. Yeah. But a cool way to start the show. This next one, all over the place, but we use TMZ for it.
Yes.
And had you heard this before I sent it to you?
I had. I actually saw it on the television screen. And I went.
Probably right when I sent it to you.
Whoa.
So, Keyless, whose milkshake brings Kalise, all the boys yes. to the yard. Kalise.
Yes.
She is now dating Peter Venkman from the Ghostbusters.
She is allegedly dating, yes.
Yeah. Bill Murray and Kalise are reportedly dating after chilling at her shows.
Did you see the title for this one?
Yes. Milkshake Murray.
which would be his MC name, I think.
Well, Bill Murray and Kalise are apparently Hollywood's newest couple, at least according to a new report that says that the two are dating.
Newest Hollywood couple.
The veteran actor and milkshake singer recently started hitting it off.
An Uber Eats commercial singer.
Those commercials are so bad. According to the U.S. Sun, I wonder if that's the same as the Sun in Britain, as far as the owners and stuff, because the Sun magazine in Britain is a big scandal sheet.
Well, yeah, you would think that it would be the same. I mean, it'd be tough to
kind of like the Daily Mail has yes. a U.S. version now. Yep. So, well, the U.S. Sun reports they've been hanging out a lot together, both in the United States and across the pond. While it may sound like an unlikely pairing at first glance, 72-year-old Bill Murray recently took in a couple of 43-year-old Kalise's shows in London, posing for a backstage photo together after at least one of the gigs. Not only that, they were reportedly also seen at the same London hotel and have been getting close since linking up stateside.
Have they been sharing milkshakes?
I don't know. I don't think I want to know. There is a common bond between them, though it's not exactly cheery. Khaleesi's second husband died last March, and Bill's estranged wife died in 21, and that's one of the things they reportedly bonded over.
That's an odd thing to bond over, but I get it. Grief does that.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't sound like Bill and Khaleesi are putting labels on their situation. The outlet cited a friend as saying whatever it is that has brought them together, and however unlikely it seems, they are both single and are having fun despite the fairly big age gap.
Fairly big.
TMZ reached out for reps for both of them and got no response. So
we got nothing.
But apparently those two got something, because something is something.
It is. And everything is everything.
Should be able to Brooklyn get that one. Vegan brings us our next one. So this is the penultimate article. How's that?
That's very nice. And you get to use a big word.
I like penultimate. It's it sounds dirty, but it's not. Cool Keith, who has 147 different personas.
Who you may have heard about in our Cool Keith special.
Well, we couldn't travel far enough into the future to find this one out to add to it. We could not. So we'll talk about it now. Cool Keith will be King Neptune at the 2023 Coney Island Memorial Parade. Now, there's a King Neptune's Cafe up in Lake George, which is really very good, actually. It's a little
farther away from Coney Island, though.
The Coney Island Mermaid Parade returns for its 41st annual edition on Saturday, June 17th, and this year's mermaid royalty have been announced. Cool Keith will serve as King Neptune, and Lori Cumbo, Commissioner of the Department of Cultural Affairs, as Queen Mermaid.
Okay.
They will join 2023 MC Shelley Watson and Bradford Scobie at the event. Go ahead.
How is it? Now, I've spoken on here before about how I stumbled onto Cool Keith performing at the Warped Tour one year. This seems just as strange to me. How does Keith end up in this ceremony as King Neptune? Well, obviously he should be King Neptune, but how does he get here? What does the path look like? From, hey, I'm putting out Black Elvis 2 to I'm going to be the head of this parade or celebration or ceremony or.
I have learned
not to ask questions,
never to question anything regarding Cool Keith.
Again,
the man has 146 personas. One of them had to be on the planning committee. That's all I can think.
Tayshaun Dorsett recommended that Cool Keith be King Neptune.
And underwear pissy was not available.
And it was seconded by Lotion Man, and the motion was carried.
And they celebrated by having chicken chow mein, man.
But it's just so crazy. It's how? You know, I know you don't watch Marvel stuff, but like in Loki, the TV series, they show how all the timelines splinter when something happens it wasn't supposed to happen.
Yeah.
I just picture that as the Cool Keith timeline. Like it's going straight, and then all of a sudden there's like seven branches that break off of it, and those could be different personalities going out and doing things and then converging back later on.
Have you seen pictures of what this mermaid parade looks like?
No.
I suggest you go to the article and scroll down to the pictures.
Oh, I saw the one where they were carrying the banner.
Oh, go down further.
Yeah.
This looks just like something Cool Keith would be part of.
It kind of does.
In fact, most of these pictures look like they could be Cool Keith album covers.
Yeah, especially the last one. Oh, no, it's not the last one. The green guy.
Yeah, the green guy.
My screen just paused as I was scrolling. Which
kind of looks like the creature from the Black Lagoon.
Kind of, but you can't say that because, you know, that also is a trademarked and copywritten property.
I'm sure it probably is, yes.
But I'm sure Cool Keith could come up with a new persona that could fit with that green guy.
Oh, I'm sure he could. But he'd have to be 8'13".
Oh, yes, because he's already green.
So he's already come up with one. He was ahead of his time on
He's always ahead of his time.
So, yes, he's go ahead and if you want to see something funky, go click on this article and scroll down to pictures of last year's mermaid parade. And, you know, it's stuff like this that doesn't help the argument that the drag queens are trying to influence kids, because there's kids in this parade.
But these aren't drag queens. They're mermaids.
Some of them are.
But they're mermaids. They can be drag maids or mer queens, or but it is in a celebration.
And then there's Mr. Roboto on here somehow, who kind of looks like he's got half of MF Doom's mask on. So, I mean, it's just – it's pretty funky stuff. But it's
Cool Keith as
– Yeah.
King Neptune.
Just somebody who's obvious lesbian holding up a sign about somebody and says, "We miss Dick." But apparently Dick is somebody they know.
Yes.
That is a little bit of a double entendre there.
The guy with the bass drum?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's just... do yourselves a favor, listeners. Go to the show notes.
Yes.
Go to MrThrowbackThursday.com. Click on the show notes for this week. Click on the article about Cool Keith and just scroll these pictures. Yes. It is...
You as
fans, it's eye-opening and somewhat eye-closing.
Yes. As fans of what we do, not necessarily of us, as fans of what we do here, you should honestly be looking at your news every day and searching Cool Keith to see if something
new comes. Something.
You really have no clue where he's going to surface or what it's going to be about. Because, again, Mermaid Festival? Nope, not what I'm thinking for Cool Keith. But
well, here's the thing. Mermaid Festival is something I wouldn't think about anybody else in hip hop, except maybe Cool Keith. If it was Ice-T or something, it's like, why the fuck is Ice-T or Nas or whomever doing a Mermaid Festival?
Oh, sorry, but
then you read it and you're like,
it's a parade. I don't know.
Mermaid how far parade. It goes. Yes,
my fault.
Because it rhymes. Yes. We should have known that. But then I read it and I'm just like, yeah, it sounds like something Cool Keith would do.
Yeah. Yeah, but you should be out there every day just searching Cool Keith in Google News.
I don't think there's anything that you could put out there that doesn't sound like something Cool Keith would do.
No, unless he's going to come like break out and do an R&B or a gospel record. You know, because I've never heard him sing. Not because I don't believe he would do. But even that
wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like something Cool Keith might try. Aria as performed by Underwear Pissy. That is going to do it for Hip Hop Headlines. We are going to take our first break of the day, and when we come back, knock on wood, we will have a special presentation for you here on Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 489.
Peace. This is the grandest of them all, even your mama fall for. Grandmaster Caz from the legendary Cold Crush Brothers, and you listen to my homeboys Jamie and Bill on the only classic hip hop podcast that matters, Mr. Throwback Thursdays. Rock out, y'all.
The OBA and the rest is FLY. The cattle pit this rhyme was my manager.
Welcome back, Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 489, and as promised, we do have indeed a very special presentation. I will turn the microphone over to the name on the marquee for the introduction.
It is very, very simple, as we always do. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, TBT Posse, please welcome to the show a hip-hop pioneer, a renegade of funk, the legendary MC Globe. Welcome to the show, Globe.
Thank you.
I'm surprised we don't have canned applause for that. We should have canned applause for that.
No, there should be real applause.
I will give applause. Yes, I will do real applause. There. And that's saying something. I had to put my coffee mug down in order to do that. So, MC Globe.
Yes, sir.
Of the seminary Soul Sonic Force.
Yes.
Mustn't forget my... other counterpart, DJ WizKid, may he rest in peace.
Yes, absolutely.
DJ, which was like super duper too also. But I am fortunate enough to share that information with all of you guys and the listeners and even more information to come in the form of entertainment. So let's keep it going. A big shout out to you guys for broadcasting and making this possible for the younger generation coming up to realize the art form that we constructed is designed for everyone to enjoy and to keep on, you know, everybody out there, just keep making your contributions to hip hop and supporting. Mm-hmm. And guys like you, you know, got to give you props. Thank you for that.
Hey, we have a bunch of silly little taglines that we put on the show. One of them is each one teach one. And I don't think anything could encapsulate that better than what was just said here. So,
Yes, coming up back in the early 70s, there was a program for children called Each One Teach One.
Really?
And it actually was based on, you know, neighborhood programs like community stuff, basketball, baseball, football, free lunches, and blah, 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 blah. So the mentality that you're expressing and the slogan that you guys use is right on point, because that is hip hop. It really is.
Yeah, that's the reason we started this show, really, was to keep the pioneers who are still working in the minds of the people who don't know they're still working, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, we have fun doing this show, and you know, we get to talk to people we listen to growing up, like you. But to let people know that they don't have to listen to whatever mass media is serving them. I mean, although I guess we are part of the media at this point, we can tell
we
them
are not mass. We may be massive, but we're not mass.
We can tell them, you know, MC Glo. Do you know that he is still working? Do you know that he is putting out new stuff with Sha Rock? Do you know, that has been our goal from the beginning. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever we benefit from that, again, getting to talk to people like you is secondary to letting everybody else know what's going on that they're not being told.
And that's been important to us since the beginning. And it's a case of, we take it on because I don't think, and we've talked about this in the past with other people, I don't think that there's enough reverence paid to those who paved the way in this specific genre of music more so than anything else. If you talk to rock and roll or current rock musicians, they will scream to the rooftops. Oh, I was inspired by the Rolling Stones. I was inspired by so-and-so. I was inspired by the Beatles. We don't hear that very much from the current crop of hip hop artists. So whether it's our duty or whether it's just something that we decided that needed to be done, that's kind of what we do. It's like, you know, we don't have a record coming out, but we do have a platform to let people know that those who paved the way deserve their flowers. And that's another one that we like to try to do is give flowers to the living, because give them to them while they can smell them, you know?
Yeah. I agree. You know, me being one of the persons that you just described, you know, hip hop is still at a young stage. It's still fairly, I won't say brand new, but it's still evolving at a young stage, at an early stage. Let me put it that way. So hopefully over a course of time, the hip hop community and those watching can come to the point where they want to give flowers to those who paved the way. And Sha Rock, when, you know, me doing a song with her, she was an MC way before me with the Funky 4+1 More, DJ Breakout, Baron, the Brothers Disco. Mm-hmm. And I used to listen to her voice echoing off the walls in the Bronx, off the buildings in the Bronx, way before I got a chance to even meet her. So to collaborate with her on a joint is like me saying I was inspired. You know, it is. I'm actually saying it. I was inspired by her to do that. So it's flowers for her big time, man. And it's cute, but she feels the same way about me. Like, we go back and forth. No, it's you, Sha. No, it's you, bro. No, it's you, Sha. You know, this. And, you know, it's up to us as pioneers and the older generation of this craft to tell the young youth that are involved to do your studying, get your history right, get your knowledge correct, which is one of the five elements of hip hop. Get your knowledge, and then you will see as you venture further into this, how difficult it must have been for us not having the technology that we have today, not having the, we were kids, we were teenagers. We didn't have, you know, the privileges, and maybe that'll turn that light on and make you say, you know what? I gotta pay homage, man. Cause it's like digging a ditch with a shovel where now you have all types of machinery to dig, you know, that's the point. And I think once that is accepted and acknowledged by the younger coming up, then they'll be able to, you know, but we'll give us some time. You know what I mean? I'm not one to beat my chest and be like, yeah, if it wasn't for me, if it weren't for me, you know, that's just not the way to address the issue. And I don't blame those that do beat their chest because
right, there's enough of them out there.
It's true.
But, it is.
You know,
it's funny. Yeah, I've noticed,
still have faith, you know?
Yeah, I've noticed that dichotomy with a lot of hip hop artists in the fact that most of them are very reticent to beat their own chest until they get on the microphone. And I think that's part of what makes an MC great is verbally beating your own chest, because you have to believe what you're saying when you're saying it, if unless you're going to convey a shitty message, basically, and you're not going to be very successful. You have to believe you're the greatest person to ever pick up that mic once you pick it up.
That is true.
So
that is true.
And it's funny you talk about still in the evolutionary phases of this. It's almost like the genre to me is in a constant state of puberty, even though the artists are not, because it does constantly change. And, you know, it goes through these different, I hate to say almost like hormonal changes, but the music itself has changed incredibly since we started listening. Yeah,
I wouldn't say evolution either, because
no. But whereas, you know, we're all getting older. I mean, Jamie and I don't look like we used to look when we were sitting in my convertible on a hilltop listening to 98.7 Kiss FM, because up here, up in about 75 miles north of the city, that was the only way we could pick that station up was driving to the top of a mountain, putting the convertible top down on my car so that the antenna could pick it up.
Yeah.
Wow. And that's what we would do. Yeah. And we did that every Saturday. People were concerned about our relationship for a while because we would get together on Saturday nights and go to a top of a hill and listen to music.
Yeah.
That's dope. But that's dope, man. That is dope.
It's going out and doing what you had to do to get the music, man. Mm-hmm. So I always like to ask the same question of everyone because, you know, the majority of them are interesting. Some are, it's my name, but where did you get the name or come up with the name Globe, and why, and why the, what's the word?
The stylistic choice.
Yes. Of G L O B E.
You know, wow. Not to put a dampen on the show, but there was a gentleman by the name of Carl Powell who just passed away yesterday. Oh. And Carl Powell was like the celebrity on our block before hip hop, because he was good looking guy. All the girls chased him around, martial artist, athlete, sold drugs. He was the bad boy, took numbers, but he was nice to everybody.
Mm.
So I grew up playing basketball and softball and football on concrete. And I developed my skills pretty good because I was out there every day. And it's a style of ball that I'm quite sure you guys are familiar with. It's called free balling, where you do a lot of fancy moves and stuff.
Yep.
So I was a chubby kid, and I would practice. I mean, man. My basketball was hitting the floor all the time. My bedroom, walked around the house with the ball. So I got really good with my ball handle. And One day, Carl was on the corner and he said, "Oh, world." Right. So then I said, that's kind of cool. So the next summer, he started saying, "Glow." I said, that's kind of cool.
I kind of like that.
I became a B-boy and everything. You know, I was round. Just work globe trials. So I said, "Okay, cool, man. Okay. Let me rock with that." So I kept the name as a B-boy, and then I became an MC, and I kept the name, and I learned how to spell my name out from listening to artists like Cowboy, may he rest in peace, for Before He Is Five, C O W B O Y. Right. So I said, "Okay, I got to start spelling my name too." So, then it got to the point where we recorded Planet Rock and all the songs, Perfect Beat, blah, 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 blah. And we were being written up in articles. And I said, I wanted my name to pop off the page. So I said, okay, I want my name in capital letters, abbreviated with dots in between, to pop right out at you.
And
so whenever you read the Times or Billboard or whatever music magazine it was, you look and you see MC Glow in capital letters. That was the reason for me doing that as far as literature was concerned. Then it got to the point where people started asking me what it meant. So I said, wow, that's, you know. So what I did was, it depended on the situation at the time. Like if it was a good looking outside, beautiful evening, that's what glow.
That's what it was going to be.
Moment. It could be God loves our beautiful earth. It could mean good looking out of any, you know.
Yeah.
So it sort of metamorphosized wherever I went. And that kept it fresh and it kept it interesting because you would never know what it means. Like right now, I would say good looking on broadcasting. Okay. You know, that's not bad. Good looking throwback on broadcasting everywhere. Yeah,
I would go with great legend of B-boy entertainment right now. So,
good one. Thank you.
There you go.
Yes.
See?
Yes.
Well, add another one to your little notebook now.
But that is a cool thing, though, because
it can mean what you want it to mean.
Whatever you're feeling at the time. And like if I call you up a week from now and say, "How you doing, Globe? How do you feel, Globe? What do you feel Globe means today?" That also gives me something to go, man, I wonder how Globe's doing. Let me see what Globe means to him today. You know, not just, yes. Hey, how's your day going?
You know, and if he doesn't want to talk, it stands for get lost, overly busy every day.
That's right.
I could do this all day.
Okay. Yes, but my favorite one was that came off the top was when I received the when I was inducted into the National Hip Hop Museum
up in DC.
And you know, Jay Kwan inducted me, and you know, I'm quite sure you guys see people getting inducted in there.
Yeah.
And he asked me, he said, "Glow, what does glow mean today?" And I said, "God loves our best efforts." You know, and that made sense to everybody in that room that was being, it was Kaz, myself, Grand Wizard Theodore, and Coke LaRock, the very first MC in the world. And it was just like those guys, like they were like, "Yo, man, that was really slick, low, you know." But
that is a mic drop moment, is what that is.
Yeah.
Good luck following that.
Yeah. So I mean, hey, it's like again speaking about evolving. It just keeps going, man. I sit up here and I write lines all the time and I figure out styles, ways of attacking tracks. And it's like, this is fun. You know, so as long as you keep that frame of mind, you can enjoy this art form and do it for the rest of your life forever, man. And that's what people have to realize. You know, I want to be the 100-year-old rapper, MC. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, yeah. The way things are going, I don't know. But, you know, so it's like I said, man, and again, to the listeners, you guys out there supporting hip hop, keep going, keep going, keep going. Don't get discouraged. Just don't hurt anybody. You know, mm-hmm. Your tongue is your most powerful weapon, and use it wisely. Mm-hmm. You know, and that, once you get a grasp of the fact that this is fun, okay, you can have all the clips you want in your gun, you know, make everybody run and all that. You can do that, but say it in a way so that, you know, it's not like you really mm-hmm. want to influence someone to go and do that. You know, it's like Bugs Bunny or McFutt. What's our guy's name?
Elmer Fudd.
Elmer Fudd. Yeah, you know, Elmer Fudd.
That big-ass shotgun he got, man. Yo.
Never hit a thing with it.
The one never hit a thing with it. Putting two fingers in it? Yeah.
Yes.
You know, so there's ways of expressing yourself without actually influencing the carrying out of the words, you know. Yeah, that's important, man. It is, man. It is.
So on that note, we have talked in the past, there has been a lot of litigation lately of artists who say things in their rhymes, which are now the lyrics are being used against them in litigation. And as somebody who writes lyrics, granted, you don't write lyrics like that, but as somebody who writes lyrics, what are your thoughts on that? Now, like, say somebody puts on paper, you know, I'm going to go bust a cap in somebody's ass or whatever, and it's not any kind of specific person. But if I come right out and say, I'm going to show up at Jamie's house and take his mailbox out with a baseball bat, and then 2 days later,
it happens,
his mailbox is taken out with a baseball bat. You know, I mean,
yes.
Where's the line on that, in your opinion, as an artist, as to what's artistic representation over an art form or actual foreshadowing of something that's going to happen?
A confession of something that did.
Or a confession of something that did. Yeah.
You know, this is the first time I've ever been asked that question. And it's a very good question, because just to think about it off the top, I watch the news. I keep up with current events and what's taking place with lyrics being used as evidence to incriminate artists. Hip hop is real, period. And gravity is real. So hip hop is as real as gravity. All right. So we've learned how to defy gravity a little bit, break dancing and with the microphone and scratches and cuts. So we have defiance of gravity a little bit, but it's real. The point is, I'm making it's real. Mm-hmm. So people on the outside looking in are saying what he's saying is real. You know, they don't realize that a lot of people, not saying everybody is faking the funk, but some are.
Right.
Some mm-hmm. are taking it to a point where they are faking the funk. They're faking. They really don't do those things. Mm-hmm. But to someone of who has knowledge of real hip hop, mm-hmm. some powerful stuff. Yeah. So, you know, it's easy to go, he ain't do that. He's just lying. But then you look at the way the person may be carrying themselves, the entourage they run with, the places they hang out, you know, all that information is gathered together, and then they pin you with what you say. It could be incriminating. So now I think the lesson is being taught that what you manifest, what you say, you know, it's a matter of manifestation mm-hmm. when it really may not be that, mm-hmm. you know, but they're looking at it like it is, like, oh, you're real? Oh, you really? Okay, well, you said so-and-so. Now, if you're so real, mm-hmm. you know, admit to it.
Yeah.
And it's like, man, the fans, people that want to have that polished, fans that want their artists, favorite artists to be a polished gangster or mm-hmm. anybody that they can look up to and say, yo, that's my dude, man. He's real. He's bad. It puts that artist on the spot because now he has to say, listen, I don't do stuff like that. Yeah. I don't own it. I don't, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
It's a tricky thing. So to answer your question, I guess I would have to say the line has to be drawn ways. You just have to be a little bit more cautious of what you say because it can get your ass in trouble.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Big
you
time.
Know, and because, you know, just as an example, Tupac was never a gangster.
That's right.
But Tupac had gangsters around him.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I believe is part of what got him taken out is, you know what? His representation. You know,
guys, this also may be a good way of cleaning up hip hop. Maybe, you know, They sat down at the table, you know, the powers that be, and said, listen, we got to clean this hip hop thing up. So we're going to start, like, these guys are talking all this stuff, man. We're going to start using that against them. Maybe they'll stop doing that and causing gun violence on the streets. It could be that, too.
Yeah.
You know, but Pac was a poet
and
an actor. He did a great job. Very entertaining, man. Mm-hmm. Can't take it from him.
No, not at all.
But he ran with dudes that was freaking
dope. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, he was not.
But. And a lot of times it's not the artists themselves. It's like you said, members of their entourage that are doing the stupidity and dragging their leader, for lack of a better word, in with them. I mean, and you know, if you think about, let's just throw this one out there. At what line do the fans start separating Ice Cube from O'Shea Jackson, the person? Ice Cube is the persona on the record. It may even be the persona that he does in you know, press conferences and stuff. But at the end of the day, his license, driver's license, says O'Shea Jackson. He's just a person.
Right. Exactly. And it's like what Shakespeare said. And like what we said in Looking for the Perfect Beat, the line that was written, actors upon the stage, you know, like everybody masks up.
Yeah.
It goes out in society. They mask up. And how you carry yourself is you know, very important in society. So if you're going to wear that mask, man, just, you know... It's just not safe anymore.
The best
thing to do is to be an entertainer, remain an entertainer. If that's your form of entertainment, then take that mask off at one point and say, listen, you know, I'm just recording records like that. I really don't do that. That'll save you a whole lot of indictment and persecution and all kinds of things that can happen to you because of your word of mouth, you know,
And you know who I think has done very well with that? And I know he's not one of your favorites, Jay, but Eminem has come out in many, many interviews and said, look, what I say on records, that's bullshitting. He goes, I don't do any of this stuff. In fact, he even made a record that about a fan. This is where the term stan came from. Right. When people say they stan something, it's basically off of that record stan, which is about a deranged fan who said, you know, sometimes I even cut myself just to see how much it bleeds in the record. And then at the end of the record, he says, in the end of the record, he says, right in the lyrics, I say that shit clowning, dog. Come on. How fucked up is you? He says. And it's, I don't think people, especially in the social media age, and like you said, people put masks on. That is a definite, deliberate act. And putting that mask on, people have to learn that actions have consequences. Mm-hmm. You put that mask on, that deliberate action, if you have to face consequences for it, then so be it, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, I was speak with the upcoming youth, the trap and the drill kids a lot that are doing this music. And I learned from them that they're only mentioning things that they see happening in their community in these songs. And they may not actually partake of it, but it's what they see. And it's almost like it is exactly like it was with us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we saw diamond rings on stars and people with yachts and beautiful cars. And that's what we rapped about.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't so much as being teenagers, because it was just right after the Vietnam War, man. We were watching vets come home, man, with no legs and arms, and they would come to the jam in wheelchairs, and you know, you could smell the heroin in the air and the dust and all that stuff. You know, it was crazy. So I can't knock these kids for what they see.
No.
And they put it on paper. Yep. You know, but it has to be addressed in a way so that people don't go out thinking that they can really emulate what they're hearing on that song.
Yeah.
And it would be really cool, guys, if there could be a stamp. You know how on a record is censored, right? Mm-hmm. It'd be cool if there could be a stamp on records that says this is not
an artistic representation.
Like,
you know what I mean? That would help a lot.
Yeah, and I think
if we could copyright that, a patent this idea,
time and date stamp. I got you.
I'll give you guys 50. I'll take 50 for that.
Sound like a plan?
Can we patent that idea?
We can do that.
No, but honestly, just having fun with you. But it's true. If you could like a stamp, like "Do Not Touch" is hot. People know this is just a record.
Yeah.
They do it on movies all the time. This movie is based on real life events. Yeah. Just based on real life events. But
I think that the problem in the social media age, though, is they carry their personas to social media, so people see them acting as if they are that person. You know, so they say, "Yeah, I heard him rap about it, but I saw him on Instagram or TikTok or Twitter, wherever."
That's that John Moran thing right now. Being
that guy. You know, so wouldn't I believe it? That's a big problem.
That's why John Morant's in the soup right now.
Yeah.
And probably facing a real long suspension from the NBA.
Wow.
Yep.
Wow.
But
yeah. Everybody, you know, we were all kids at one time, and to the listeners out there that are still children, young, you know, we emulated things that made us feel super too, man.
Yeah.
You know, I used to get sneakers and stuff to make me think I could run faster and jump higher.
Exactly.
You know how it goes, guys. Yeah.
I used to buy Reebok pumps for the same reason. I thought pumping up my sneakers was going to give me an extra half a second on a run, or an extra 2 inches on a vertical leap.
Yeah.
And I still couldn't dunk, and I still got dunked on. So those pump sneakers didn't do jack shit, but...
It's all about the market.
So yeah, man. I mean, it's all human imperfection, and the only way you can correct it is to address it. And if it's going to scare an artist to stop him from writing lyrics about things that he has done to harm others, and he gets caught, and they bring it up, and you know, if it's going to turn things up, that's great. But again, man, it's all art, and that's it. Yeah. That's it. It's human imperfection. What are we going to do about it?
Like you said, if we could start putting that little warning label on every record that says, you know, record based off of real life events, not an actual historical account or something like that. I mean,
All right. So we're looking at, and it just blows my mind to think about this because it means I'm getting old. We're looking at 40 years since Play That Beat, Mr. DJ.
Yep.
How did you hook up with WizKid?
Oh, wow. Well, Wiz was always... Oh, man, forget about it. Yo, Wiz was a whiz on the turntables. There's still things on the turntables that he has done that people aren't up on yet, which, you know, everybody comes up with their own style of doing things. I'm just saying he was really at it, man. He was really at it. I had the Mel Starr DJing for me a couple of weeks ago at an event. And he was like, "Yo, man, WizKid, man, what was it like to be around him, man? Blah, 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 blah." And he already had his reputation for being a DJ. Mind you, while he was doing that, outside, he was also a real musician playing instruments.
Really?
And he was working with other MCs. You know, he cut and scratched for the Funky Four plus one more. There's another group that he worked with. So to get to the story, he was working in the record room for Tommy Boy. And this is after The Rock had came out. And Tom is like, damn, man, Globe is fucking good. Globe needs to do something on his own. You know, let me get Globe his own shine, man. And he asked me, he says, how would you like to work with Wizkid? I said, what? I said, of course. Now, Wiz and I used to bypass each other in the T-Connection, XT Garage, all these places. And, like, he, sometimes I would turn, and I would see him on the turntable cutting and scratching, you know, because DJs would switch up. You wouldn't even know, you know, until you looked. So I saw Wiz, and, like, he'd go in for me. And every time I talked to him, he would say, yo, man, you know, you that dude, man. You know, it's way before records. He always acknowledged me. I'd say, nah, man, you're the dude. You're the freaking dude. You know, so make long story shorter. Yeah, we met through Tommy Boy in the record industry. I think Tom had to know all this stuff that we knew each other already, but we were both blown away. Hell yeah, I'll do it. Hell yeah. So I said,
my arm.
I said, I got to come up with a song that's going to put Wiz on blast. I got to do a song that's going to make Wiz famous, like make the world know about him because he's so dope. Mm-hmm. So I said, I'm going to do a song about the DJ.
That is the precursor to Flowers for the Living all the way back then.
Yeah, that's what that is.
I said, I'm going to put him on. And I just came up with a way. I said, I'm going to make it radio all day. I'm going to design this song so that they play on the radio all day. And they still do today.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm going to put our names in it like I did with all our records, if you notice.
Yes.
I put our names in all our, you know, So Sonic Force, Mr. Biggs, Bow Wow, GLOB. I put them in all of our records.
What artist doesn't sign his art, you know?
Yeah.
If it's on canvas, they put their signature in that corner.
Boom.
Yep.
So, that's how it worked out with Wiz, man. And through the grace of God, man, we got fortunate. Tom promoted the heck out of it. And it's sort of like what we're doing with the Sha-Rock MC Globe song.
Yes, that we played last week.
The contest.
Yes. I was going to say, which, by the way, let me interject. Banger. Okay, that's all I needed to say. Banger of a song.
Thank you. And, you know, Tom broadcast advertised a contest in Billboard, and the winner would receive, I think it was, I don't know. Well, anyway, that song would be played all the time. Their mix would be played, rather, all the time. And Double D and Steinsky, of course, you know, won, and that's what happened. So that's what we're doing with this song. We're going to have a contest mix, you know. Mm-hmm. Eric Moore, Resume Records. And we're going to see how it works out. But we were fortunate back then to have the machine we had behind us because Tom was not playing around. Tom is an excellent businessman. And he was not afraid to ask questions. And I learned a lot from him because, I mean, he didn't even call me and ask me questions. And I'm like, yeah, well, you know, spontaneously answer.
Right.
You know, and, you know, but it was business is business, guys.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't mix it with friendship. You can't mix it with blood. You can't do that. It's because they're numbers, period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, but we were fortunate enough to get that machine behind us. And unfortunately, we never got a chance to perform, play that beat live together.
Wow.
Never.
That's crazy.
That's crazy nuts. We never did a video. You know, Wiz moved to Seattle. He got married.
Yeah, he was on Nasty Mix, wasn't he? He was out there on Nasty Mix Records when he went out there to Seattle?
Possibly.
Yeah.
I can't, you know, answer that, you know.
Yeah.
But possibly, yes. He was, you know, working with a lot of European artists also. He was doing his thing, man. He was getting it in. And, man, we have like three other songs that we were working on. And one of them is called This Beat Is From the Bronx. And they're re-releasing it this year.
Really?
They're going to release it for the first time this year. And nice. That's, oh, man. The record company that bought Tommy Boy, Reservoir.
Yes, Reservoir. Yep.
Media. Mm-hmm. They're going to release it probably by the end of this year. But there were other songs, man. Two other songs. Oh, my God, man. Wiz. Man, we had the formula, man. We had it for live performances. And I look at Will and Jeff, right? Mm-hmm. And I say to myself, that's me and Wiz. You know, the way they rock together.
Yeah.
Will Smith and Dash. That's the plan I had with Wiz, man. Make them shine, do beautiful, magical things with the DJ. So that's how that happened.
Yeah. And it's sad that doesn't happen anymore. I mean, the DJ has essentially been removed from, and I'm not going to say from hip hop because DJs are out there working all the time. That's not, they have been taken out of the group element, you know, mm-hmm. where the DJ
the group performance equation doesn't yeah. have the DJ
where the DJ is what started everything, you know, and, mm-hmm. and, you know, the MC would get a mic if the DJ let him have a mic, you know, mm-hmm. now
that's right.
Now those rappers that are out there don't even have a DJ.
You know, I mean, why did Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five was named after the DJ yeah. and then the other people around him. So yeah. that tells you how important the DJ was.
Yes, indeed. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. So. You know, I'm gonna tell you guys, if you could come up with that show, man, like Houdini, they had a really dope show too.
Yeah.
What was the DJ's name, guys?
For
Houdini? Just with him the other
for Houdini.
Grandmaster D.
Boom.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
When they did the garden for the first time, what was it? The Summer Fest.
The summer, yeah.
Holy cow! This dude taking off his sneakers, and it was the talk of the town because of DJ Jam Master Jay. He went in hard too, yeah. you know. Mm-hmm. You know, and you need that element. Yeah. You can get on stage and you know do your thing, but man, that DJ is all man. That makes it complete. And of course, dancers.
Yeah,
you know, mm-hmm. but yeah, man, it's like that's my headset to always acknowledge the DJ first, man. Always,
yeah,
always.
Yeah. You know, it was funny. Yeah, so Chuck D just posted yeah. the other day something about he's hey, you remember when Biggie threw a bottle of water at his DJ for messing up? I'm like, that would never have happened.
Mm-hmm.
Ever
years before,
you know, you wouldn't be back on the microphone. That dude would not perform with you.
Nope.
No.
That was just a crazy thing.
Yeah, you know, they may have planned it too. You never know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, part of the act. Yeah, you don't know
because you know. I'm gonna share this with you guys. I hated it, but when we first started going out on the road, we used a live band,
mm-hmm.
right? Because people weren't understanding us coming in there with two turntables and rhyming. They never saw that before in mm-hmm. the southern states, what's called the Chitlin Circuit.
Yes.
They never saw that.
What, they were used you to down there with Mom's Mabley? Bands. What are you doing?
Yeah, like, we, you know, we paid $50 to get in here. Where's the band?
Yeah.
You know, and
just going to play records?
So what happened was, band members, you know, started falling off and we had to go back to records. And what we would do if the record jumped, which
happened, yeah,
we take the record off the turntable, break it, throw it out to the audience and put a fresh. But that was the most abuse that was going to take place on stage between
yeah.
and MC, man. You know, water is the best conductor, man.
Yeah.
He can't be playing around like that.
No, but anyway, no.
It was classic shit for Biggie to do that, man. Yeah. It's classic shit. It gave people something to talk about.
And it adds to his persona, you know, his legacy. Remember that time? Yeah.
Oh, shit. Excuse me, guys. I'm having a ball talking about this. This is so much fun, man.
That's good.
The thing is, in a case like that, if it happened only once, then it's like, holy shit, did you see what Biggie did? Right. If it shows up in every show, then it's no different than Gene Simmons spitting blood out. It becomes part of the act. You know, then it becomes choreographed. And then you're two steps away from professional wrestling. So.
I don't even like throwing water on the audience on, you know, I don't. You have women out
we
there
know somebody who does, though. Redman will do it.
Yeah.
Redman will do it if he catches you on your phone at one of his shows. He'll threaten you. He's like, you come to watch the show, you watch it through your eyes, not through a phone screen. And if I see you watch it through a phone screen, I'll throw water on you.
Yeah.
And he does it.
That's funny. Oh, shit.
Redman's nuts. That's part of the reason why we love him.
It's one thing to, you know, take a picture at a show so you can remember it, but you got to be there.
I guess because it never entered my mind to do it, but I know that, you know, you're not just hitting that one person that you're aiming at. You're hitting the person next to you, too.
And three,
collateral damage.
I'm talking in the mirror, man. They, you know, girls spend time in the mirror getting ready for that show.
Oh, I got a wife and daughter. I know.
Man, you already know. It's like,
it has nothing to do with a show. They do it for work. They do it to go to the grocery store.
Yeah, man. It's funny. But, yeah, man, 43 years.
That's crazy.
Yep.
And it holds up today, man.
It does.
You could listen to that right now and be like, yep, I get every word he's saying.
Yeah, play it for the Whiz Kid.
Yeah, yeah.
Do it for the Glow. GLOBE. Yes. I mean, it's.
Yes. Yes. It also, which was really cool, there's a series, Snowfall. Mm-hmm. And it actually featured in one of their episodes. And the fly part was they played the words, the caption.
Really?
And they used the part that said, play it for Globe.
Nice.
My phone exploded. Yo, Globe, man, your song's on Snowfall. Like, yes, ching, 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 ching. Shit, yeah. And let people, you know that original, authentic hip-hop is always going to foundate whatever's taking place today. And like I said, I don't knock anybody out there that's doing hip hop. Your style of hip hop is your style.
Yeah.
You know, it's still your art. It's what you do, but we need that stamp on the record.
Yes.
And as your style of art, that throws me to my next question. MC popping is a MC Globe invention. You were the first guy to basically rapped somewhat off the beat. What made you think, you know what, this is what's going to set me apart and make people notice me? How'd that come about?
Well, we would listen to everyone's cassette tapes. Powell and I would sit down and listen to everybody's show. And I said, man, everybody's starting to sound alike.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. If we're going to take over, we got to do something different. So it was a combination of anger. It was anger, being competitive, and you could say a little bit of a malfunction, like a mistake.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I just started twisting words around, you know, like snap at the crack of the body, the apple, the one and only, the mac of the roll, never let's try to triple it up, quack, jubile it up, shake it and bring it, it takes it, make it pop, and then I wanted it to be like pop, 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 pop. Like you can't beat that. Pop it, pop, 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 pop. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's what started it. It was a combination of those things: anger, being competitive, and a little bit of, I don't want to say luck, but just being like,
sometimes it's better to be lucky than good.
Yeah. Just thinking and practice, because it's hard to do it. I came up performing live. I didn't have, like I was saying earlier in the interview, we didn't have the technology we had to hit the streets, man. We was like, just a microphone. That's it. No headset. No, yo, start it over again. None of that shit.
No.
No. Fucked up. Pass the fucking mic. You stutter, pass the mic. You fucked up, man. Get out of here. You're not getting on next week.
Yeah.
We were like that. We were hard like that on each other. You're not getting on next week, yo. Your name beat through the streets of the city. Yo, dude is whack. Don't let him get on your set. Yeah, he's whack.
You busted the flow that we had going. You cannot be here.
Yeah. Tighten your shit up and see me in private before I let you get back out there.
Yeah, you know, there's no, you couldn't,
it's like punch. Auditioning.
Yeah, exactly. There's no punching, nothing like that. Mm-hmm. It was just that, and just practice, man. So when I took it to the Rock, of course, you know, I had to say it, got a Rock MC popping because again, I want people to know, you know, Renegades of Funk, popping the shock of the Rock and the putting aside the hip hopping. Popping is in there.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, you know, looking for the perfect beat is a pop. Looking for the perfect beat. It's same shit. And like, you know, which I give Arthur and John a lot of credit for listening, man. I was very much like a stallion. You had the Bronco bust me, but you couldn't break me. So they would say, well, you're rapping off beat. I'd say, nah, man, this is how it goes. Mm-hmm. This is how it goes.
See, it's harder work for me to do it this way than for you to be on beat.
I'm rapping in my style. If the beat happens to correspond to it, that's great. If not, I ain't changing shit. Yeah.
And I believe that has evolved to where Busta Rhymes is now.
Mm-hmm.
From where
you know what? I'm gonna be honest. Like, fast rapping has been around for a long time.
Yes.
The Tetris 3 with the new rap language, mm-hmm. right? Debonair Pioneer standing here speaking clear without a cable wave here watching other people stare at Rickinator, Barkinator, Devastator, Kusinator, not today, the motivated MC. You know, that style.
Yes.
On Enjoy Records, right? So that, like, you can find people twisting words around, right? And it may have, with the industry, maybe it may have been a little more acceptable because we were doing it. But again, everybody has their own way of doing things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I can't say, yeah, wasn't for me. Twist wouldn't be twisting. With the M wouldn't be the M. You know, bus wouldn't be
chip
busing.
Chip Fu wouldn't be going 1,000 miles an hour on Fushnikin's records. Das Effects wouldn't be throwing Iggy in every word.
But you know, I can hear that off in Busta.
Humbly speaking, it's not difficult if you practice it and you actually do become you're your own person. Then you like, it's like, look at this, like with basketball, you see someone dunk the ball. The first person to dunk the ball, okay, he dunked it, but then you got Dr. J who started making magic with it, you know, but he wasn't the first to dunk that ball. He just was like, you know, he was, you know, and you just, the list goes on of people who reinvent things. And that's what hip hop is. Mm-hmm. It's a reinvention of everything.
Yes.
And that's humbly, truthfully speaking, coming from me, the GLOBE, the baddest MC that the world's ever seen. Take it or leave it. It's not true.
Now I found out something.
We're all bad. Every one of us.
Shit. I agree.
Every one of us.
I found out something that I did not know. You know, and Bill will tell you, one of the things I do for this show is research heavily. Like, we have less than a week in between. So we record on Sunday, and by Friday, I usually have him a new show.
That's why I'm glad he's retired from the Navy and I'm still working.
But 20 years, man.
Yeah.
Jeez.
But
wow, things you know.
He doesn't even look like he did 20 years in the Navy. I expected him to look like, you know, some old seafaring guy with a wooden leg and all that.
I mean, he's got a bad knee.
He's got a fake knee, but that's about it.
But no, really,
because I love hip hop so much, so I end up down rabbit holes like you can't even imagine. But one of the things that I found out, and I'm kind of irritated that I didn't know, is that you were on New Edition's debut album.
A little. Well, let me tell you that story.
Because I don't hear you rapping, so that's so I didn't no, feel no, I didn't feel so bad that I didn't know.
The only thing I said on which one song, Arthur called me in. He asked me to do like a rap song for them, mm-hmm. and I wrote this past the beat song for them, but. Those boys were rapping, those gentlemen were rapping way before I came along and tried to write a rap form. And with the rap that I wrote for them, I tried to make it a little sing-songy.
Yep.
It didn't work well. it wasn't like they know how to rap.
Right.
They knew how to rap already. And for me to come in. And assist, okay, I'll do what I can, yeah. You know. But, yeah, those boys, those gentlemen are singers and entertainers. And how I got special thanks on the record was just out of sheer respect for me. You know, Reese had a lot of respect for me. Arthur. And I was just cool, man. So they gave me that. The only thing I did say on that record is my name, the GLOBE. Yeah. The name of the song is Pass the Beat.
Pass the Beat, yeah. But,
mm-hmm. Yeah, it was more like it was the early stages of hip hop being commercialized, mm-hmm. and those guys, man, New Edition, those five guys, they were already rhyming and rapping.
Yeah, I mean,
they were already doing it.
Yeah, the big hit off of that record, Candy Girl, they got a break where they break it down and they rap. Mm-hmm. But yes, when I saw that, I said, all right, wait a minute. I'm really familiar with New Edition. I'm really familiar with that album. I said, I have to go back. But yes,
it was more like paying homage to me, which is very cool, man.
That is very cool.
That was so cool, man. You know, and I used to, the first show we did with them was at the Pier. And they wanted to stay and see us perform. So, you know, I remember these little dudes, man, I'm standing in front of these little dudes. And I'm saying to them, listen, don't smile.
Be hard.
Take your pictures and stuff. Don't smile because you never seen God. Right. And up there looking at me, probably, what the fuck is he talking about? But that's how I was taught when I was a kid on my block. Like, you know, really like rough people, man, on my block. If they said they were going to do something to you, really believe me, the next morning you heard so-and-so said he, and they did it.
Yeah.
You know, you had guys to rob the corner store every Friday. And you knew he was coming, like the Wild Wild West. It was crazy. Shotguns, you know, it was crazy. But anyway, I was raised that way to be tough. You know what I'm saying? And I remember saying that to them. I wonder if they remember that. But it was the coolest thing because he's little too. Don't smile. You know, when I see that, like, when
we're
I see that picture,
Jackson 5, they we're supposed to smile.
Up, you know, huh? Say, if you look at a lot of their album covers, they're really not smiling on a lot of them.
I could see them, though, having an issue going, we're supposed to be the next Jackson 5. We're supposed to smile.
Yeah, those little dudes, I love those boys. I'm so proud of them. But yeah, that's how that happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's how that happened, you know, out of just respect, man.
Yeah,
and I know they probably sit down and say, yo, how did Glo get involved with it? And then they probably say, oh, yeah, he wrote that whack ass pass the beat to us. We ain't doing that shit.
I don't know if I can hear Ralph Tresvant in his voice saying that whack ass.
But you know, it's fun, though. I had a chance for them to say all their names in the song.
Nice.
And that's important.
Yeah. Yep.
You know,
because why wouldn't they? Because you're the GLOBE and you mentioned Wiz in yeah, you know, play that beat. So,
yo, man, I give people their props, man.
That's a globism right there. Yeah. Get the name in the song.
Yeah.
Let them know. Let them know who's bringing it.
They did it in Candy Girl. Ronnie, Bobby, Ricky, and Mike. Man. Yeah.
They did it in, what? Didn't they do it in Mr. Telephone Man too?
Yeah, they did.
Probably. I think they did.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
So.
Wow!
And somehow this turned into a New Edition love fest, which is fine. I love New Edition, man. That Heartbreak record was on constant play for me for about a year and a half.
Fascinated by those guys, man. The energy it takes to do what they do, their own individual lives off stage and on stage, they're amazing. Yeah. They've been programmed to win, and that's all they're going to do. They're always going to win, always. You know. That's the programming, man. That's it. Mm-hmm. That's it. You know, just go.
Yep.
Just
whatever you do when you leave the stage, but you get out there and you do your thing.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Right. Because the stage is your canvas. You are an artist. Yeah. And again, separation of art from person.
Yeah.
And we go full circle. Yeah. We have a couple of questions we ask everybody who comes up here. If you had to pick an album that you would say, if you are going to listen to one album to figure out what hip hop is, what album would you recommend?
An album or a single? An album.
Which you can do both, actually.
For somebody who doesn't know hip hop, because and you want to try to give them a song that encompasses it so they'll have an understanding.
Because the song we both picked to define hip hop is not on the album we picked to define hip hop. So it is two separate things.
Okay. I would say Love Rap by Spoonie G.
Spoonie G. Yeah. Oh,
Spoonie G. Wow.
Love Rap by Spoonie G. And album wise, I would say Fearless Four. And Grandmaster Flash.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
You know, those like that and the Furious Five albums. Definitely Fearless Four and all the stuff that Flash and the Five did. Mm-hmm. And single would be Spoonie G's Love Rap.
Nice.
Because he's rapping to the girls.
Yeah.
He's talking about how dope he is. It's crazy, man. crazy. Yeah, and then of course play that beat.
Well, of course, you know what I mean? Of course.
I mean,
but we always say you have to disqualify your own stuff. You know, if you were just a fan, because that would make perfect sense.
Looking for the perfect sense. Yeah,
there you go. Spoonie G is a name we bring up from time to time on this show, but I don't think it's nearly enough credit. So there's a lot of those kind of artists.
Boy, man, Spoonie is lethal. He's lethal, man. Him, the Treacherous, forget about it. They were way ahead of their time, man. You know, and big shout out to all of them. But L.A. Sunshine, he makes it clear publicly that he wishes he had made Play That Beat.
He actually says that.
Mm-hmm. L.A. Sunshine, and I'm drawing back. Why? Because they had crazy flow too.
Yeah.
You know, it becomes an art, man, when you go into that. Yo, fellas, man, it's adios, Samuel. So, yeah, man.
Sunshine was a B-boy too.
If I have to pick favorites, but
I was going
to
say, Sunshine started out as a B-boy too.
He's still he still dancing does, with Mo D.
Yeah. Mo. K.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Now, again,
big shout out to the Cold Crush Brothers too, man.
Grandmaster Caz of the legendary Cold Crush Brothers.
There you go. That's it, man. That's my buddy, right? That's my brother right there, man. Caz, all day. All day. Caz has a lot to put up with me, though. I call him crying and shit.
Hey, that's it comes with being
Caz
boy,
ever
right?
Just looks at his phone and goes, nope, not today, and just puts it down and goes to voice.
I did that once with him. But you know, it's like he answers the phone, man. It's like you have to have that real you with real people. Mm-hmm. You know, there's nothing wrong with expressing yourself. You know, but yeah, man, that's my big brother right there, man. He got me. He got me.
Yeah. So I tell you, I go down deep rabbit holes when I'm researching. One of the hardest things for me to do on this show over the past 9 years is to find a hip hop Christmas album for our Christmas episode. Because you would think that there would be more. There's not a lot out there.
You guys are familiar with the Jingle Bells that I did?
1992. Yeah, I found that during my research. And it is now going to be this year's Christmas album for the Christmas episode.
That is a small and distinguished list.
Seriously. How do you,
that was fun, man.
I say, how does it come to you make a Christmas album? And was it 1992? That's the date that it shows as the release, but I don't know if that's
probably was. It probably was.
So what inspires a Christmas album in 1992? What?
Okay.
What happened? The label was saying you owe us two more records. And it's December.
John Henderson and another gentleman by the name of Michael Carrera, who is the director of the Children's Aid Society for Sinai Hospital here in New York. The collective of them and whoever else is involved wanted to put a message out about puberty. Right. Mm-hmm. So they asked me to.
It's a terrible thing. I don't recommend it. It was bad for me.
You know, hepatitis and all that stuff. So they gave me what they wanted me to say, and I just had to put it in a rhyme form and put it to music. Mm-hmm. Once they saw I could do that, they said, shit, go fucking do a fucking Christmas album. That's easy too. Okay, what do you want me to do? So I took the exact lyrics from all the Christmas songs and I flipped it and made it what it is. It was fun doing it, man.
It looks like
it was. But yeah, there you go. That's how that came about.
Yeah. And that one threw me. I said, what?
Yeah, that was fun. That was a lot of fun.
He actually texted me too. He's like, did you know Globe made a fucking Christmas record? I said, no, I didn't.
And we have an exclamation here, you know, Turbo Vikings on Twitch here. His name is John Henderson. So
he just said, did Globe just say my name? Yes. Yes. Yes.
So yes, John, you got a personal shout out from Globe.
You get something from our prize bucket because your name got mentioned.
All right.
Peace, John.
And again,
yes.
down the rabbit hole of things I didn't know. You did a song in 2017 for the Universal Hip Hop Museum's record that I didn't know existed.
Yes.
I blame Adam Silverstein for not telling me it existed. But
yeah, we're going to have to yell at Adam when we talk.
Oh, I did already. It was 16 bars for hip hop. Yes. And the song was I Can't Stop. How did you?
That
happened in 2017, but nobody told me.
I was asked, like, you know, Globe, we would like you to contribute to the bars of rap for the museum. I'm like, cool, no problem. You know, no proceeds are coming back. It's all for the museum. Cool, let's do it. So I have a lot of songs in the stash, and that was one of them. No effort at all.
Right.
You know, just a matter of just being humble and looking out for the culture and wanting to support the museum. Let's do this bad boy. Put this, you know, let me listen to it, see what I need to do to polish it up, whatever. Blah, 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 blah. And that's how that happened. But there is another one that's with the museum now called hip hop. I don't know if you guys, I know you do because you do your research, but it's very simple. Hip hop, love my hip hop, gotta have my hip hop. I did that also for the museum.
Nice.
Which is going to be like, they have it on their website now. Mm-hmm. They play it, whatever they have, they use it, which is great.
Yeah.
And it's going to be licensed out by Sony. See if we can get some clicks.
Nice. From it
on that. But yeah, that album was really, that was a good album, man. It was a lot of great songs on that Universal Hip Hop album, man. It was a lot of.
I looked at it and I like the names that I recognized.
16 Bars of Rap, right?
That's
the name of it, 16 Bars of Rap. Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of great stuff, a lot of talent, a lot of artists I never heard of.
That was the thing for me. I looked at it, because a lot of it right now on Spotify doesn't exist. Like, everything's grayed out. And I don't know if that's because the artist doesn't want it on there, if they don't have whatever reasoning. But the names I recognized was like you and Chip Fu. And like, I knew no other names on that list. I'm like, I got to check some of these out because they're on this album. And if you're on it and Chip's on it, some of these cats got to be good.
Yeah.
So, there was some cool stuff on that album, man.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that didn't just have hip hop on it. It had R&B on it. It had little reggae. Mm-hmm. It's like really dope. Yeah. I was very impressed. Yeah, man. Great young artists out there, man. I mean, wow.
Again, I blame Adam. I blame Rocky. I blame Paradise. I blame all those guys for not mentioning it to us. We're the platform to put it out there, but I don't think we were really connected with them at that point.
No, not if it was in 17.
Yeah, it was in 17.
We got really involved, I think, with them probably, right around COVID.
Yeah.
I think. So, late 19, early 20. So,
but I can still blame them.
No. Who do we blame?
And I don't have it handy because I have to switch my banks because I was not prepared. But it's
this is Billy Dan's, by the way, saying this.
Not that one.
whenever anything goes wrong on the show, it's always he's got no, his thing. Saying, yeah, it's always my fault. That's Billy Dan saying that it's my fault.
No, it's Bill's fault. Yeah, there it is. I don't know why that one's playing. That one's got to stop.
So that's who we blame. You can blame Adam and everything all you want, but it's always going to come back to me.
It's Bill's fault. Yeah.
There's certain things. Death, taxes is Bill's fault.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
I guess we all have our cross to bear.
Yes.
But yeah, we are going to bring that up to Adam and Rocky and Paradise and when we talk to them next. Yeah. Adam should be coming on again soon. He's due to make an appearance. We got to talk to Ed too. We haven't made a trip to Toontown in a while. Yeah.
Now, I have a strange question for you, and I've only asked one other person because we only had one other person on here that was in the movie that I'm going to mention. What is, in your opinion, the greatest Christmas movie of all time?
The greatest Christmas movie of all time.
It's a strange question, right?
It takes me to Christmas right away. Oh, man. It would have to be.
It's not going to be the same as what I say.
But he's not going to say what you want him to say. And I love it. And I am just sitting here.
I know he won't
like
say it.
Like Snidely Whiplash waiting for an answer because I know it's not going to be what you wanted to say.
I'm going through so many right now, but it would have to be Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
That is a quality choice.
It's not Beat Street.
With a red nose flying around.
Yeah.
I mean, I like the story about Ebenezer Scrooge also.
Christmas Carol, yes.
I love that too. But if I have to give you my favorite, it's Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Now let me tell you, waiting for you to say Beat Street.
My favorite is Beat Street.
Oh, well, see, I don't look at. You know what? You know what's funny, guys?
I told you
it's a Christmas movie, but I don't look at it like there was, because I was I'm in it, like I played such a role in it as far as helping, you know, consultation and talking to Harry every day at 6 o'clock in the morning for 5 days a week. May he rest in peace. That was an experience, man. I was never late either. I was always on time. My little Ashley case and everything. But that is a Christmas movie. But I can't say, well, God, you know what? All my Beach Street peers, don't shoot me out the water. It was a trick question.
Don't worry, I can edit it.
I make you look good. Beach Street is dope. But, you know, Beach Street is so in my blood. It's like, it's hard for me to have an out-of-body experience and look at that movie and say, yeah, this is a Christmas movie. I just remember it being very, it's a Christmas movie. Bottom line, it's a Christmas movie, but
okay, all right. If Globe says so, I will change my opinion on it because he was involved in it. I've now been, you know, I've been converted.
Like, yeah, man, it's like it's just a dope fucking time in hip hop, man. It's like that movie, man. Oh my God, and the people. I'm just thinking about all the people that were there that actually, the performers and the actors and the actresses. Shaw Rock
once again.
The producers and just how much fun it was doing that. Going overseas and promoting it in Spain and being on live television in Spain and doing the Cannes Festival and oh my God.
But, was that the first Fresh Flicks we ever did, Jay?
You know? I think so, yes.
We do
a segment every month called Fresh Flicks, where we get together online and we get some of our posse members to join us and we watch a hip hop themed movie. Beach Street was the first one we ever did as a Fresh Flicks segment. Yeah. So
okay.
And it wasn't in Christmas either. I think we watched it in like Christmas July.
It's like Crazy Eddie though. Yeah. It was Christmas in July.
Amazing movie, man. Oh my God.
It is an amazing movie.
Yes.
There's no two ways about it. Whether it's a Christmas movie or not, until today I would have debated, but now
it's a Christmas movie.
I've been converted.
I would say it's my favorite hip hop movie because it represented hip hop the best, I think, as a film. You know, because Breakin' was focusing on Breaking, you know, it wasn't focusing on the other elements as much, although Ice-T was in it and the Glove, but it focused on just dance in California. Beach Street, while Breaking was a very key element, you know, and prevalent throughout the film, it showed you everything. You know, and so that is
showed you the street art. It showed you the music. It showed you
the dancing. Obviously.
It showed, I mean, it,
you know, Double K even, out there DJing,
and to a lesser extent, showed you the wardrobe.
Yeah,
I mean, it was all tied in. It was a great. We have a request from the aforementioned John Henderson wants to know if you can share any stories about Harry Belafonte.
I'll put it up on the screen.
Oh wow! Absolutely. Wow.
By the way, rest in peace to Harry Belafonte. I have said, if nobody has ever seen it, you need to go back and watch the induction of Public Enemy into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame when Harry introduced them. And before he inducted them, to hear him read the lyrics to Don't Believe the Hype made all the hair on my arm stand up. It's just something about him.
Yeah, Harry, his energy, total positivity. A lot of people are misunderstood. Because we're all imperfect beings. But Harry was total positivity. And one story I will share with you, John, is our looking for the perfect beat was the second hottest song on the chart. And the New York Times did an article on it. So the morning that I was on my way to see Harry, one of the mornings, I picked up the paper and I'm like, holy shit, they hooked us up like this? I was like blown away. So I ran in the office and said, Harry, look at this. Harry took the paper from me and illuminated the article right there in my face. He cut it out, took his time, illuminated it right there, put it in the plastic, and gave it to me. Ah. That was a moment because, and he had a smile on his face the whole time, like it was Christmas. You know, he was so like, had to smile like, no, wow, Glow, congratulations. He cut it out. He put illuminated for me. I'll never forget that. Wow. I'll never forget that. And if you want to hear one more, God, may he rest in peace. He was a very, very comical man also. I brought a track in Frantic Situation. And in the vamp of the track, you know, he would play anything I brought in there real loud. I mean, the whole avenue could probably hear it. But I guess he was doing that so the staff and everybody could, you know. And in the vamp of the song, there was a vocalist where he was hitting some notes that were like screeching, man. It's horrible. It was horrible. And Harry looks at me. He says, is that you singing that, Glow? I said, no, sir. Not I. But, yo, those are two stories, you know, I'll share with you, John, about Harry, man. He was just powerful, man. Powerful. I learned so much dealing with him in those 5 days up close and personal like that, man. It's like dope. Wish we had phone cameras back then. If we had camera phones back then, oh my God.
You'd be in trouble today.
We would be in trouble today.
Yeah, we would.
Having never had the privilege to meet Harry Belafonte, just seeing him in things that he's done, I don't know that I can imagine that there was a more genuine human being on the face of the earth. I get the feeling what you saw was what you got with him.
I agree. You know, hey, fellas, like I said, we live in an imperfect society. We mm-hmm. are imperfect, and people see things the way they see it, like you said. And people see things from a different angle, and they have their opinions. Mm-hmm. That's great, you know. But I only saw positive energy. And that's all I got to say about them. That's it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right.
What's it now, man? Wow. I mean, it's a lot of work being an actor, a recording artist, an activist. It's a lot of work,
yeah,
man.
I bet.
Mm-hmm. A lot of sleepless nights, man.
Yeah, because you got to take off one hat and put on another one and do the other job. Yeah.
It's hard enough to do all three, but to do them at the level he did, that's something even more impressive. Yeah. I mean, I could do a lot of things. I could be the jack of all trades and master of none.
Ryan Seacrest.
But or Steve Harvey, depending on your audience. But I couldn't be a jack of all trades and master of every single one I tried, like I saw with Harry Belafonte.
Yes.
You and Sha Rock got together, put out some new music. You told us that there's going to be a Globe and Wiz release coming up. Is there more music on the horizon from what we like to refer to as real hip hop artists?
Well, you know, I may have you on one, Jamie. This one might have got past you.
Uh-oh.
World Without End.
Early this year, right? Like January time frame?
Yeah. You can't, get past plan. Me.
I told you. He researches like crazy.
I am
get past Jamie. What?
I am retired. I sit home all day.
No, he's flypaper. You're not getting that shit past him. He is flypaper.
I'm always looking for stuff from you guys.
That was fun stuff. But oh yeah. There's a follow up single coming out on Zoom Records with Eric Moore, and a big shout out to that whole camp, man. Out there in Ireland, Dublin, Willie. Wishing you the best, Willie. And the rest of the Scratch team, quartet, they call themselves, that did the work scratching on the song and the production and stuff. But yes, there's a second single coming out, follow up. It's just me.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk to Sha about doing a second one because I have a really dope song that I said, you know, it's funny because like for the last 3 days, I've been reconstructing it and making it more like 2024, 2025. And I may ask Sha to guest appear on it. But otherwise than that, Soul Sonic Force is basically just doing shows. You know, that's where that's at. But I'm constantly up to something. And that's because I like what I do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
all right.
If it sticks.
And if you like what you do, you never work a day in your life. Right. If you you love what you do, you never work a day in your life.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Mm. Yes, I but you know, I worked for Steinway and Sons for 18 years and still doing the music. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Steinway, may he rest in peace. I have pictures of him and I together, and he was something else. I had a chance to, I think I touched just about, I had to touch every piano that before it left.
Went out, yeah.
So I see these super mega artists like what's her name, the beautiful
Alicia Keys.
Boom, she did her video there for one of her songs, and you know, I was there when like a lot of celebrity artists come and pick their piano out of the showroom, and it has to be wrapped and boxed and blah 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 blah. And I would always like tap on it a little bit, but yeah, that I did that, but that was work. I loved being there. I loved the staff. And the crazy part about it, guys, is that nobody knew what I did. Nobody knew that I was recording artists because I didn't run around like that. I didn't run around we're battling and.
So now I'm going to go watch an Alicia Keys video, and I'm going to think to myself, Globe probably played chopsticks on that piano before it was delivered.
Yo, man, it was like, whoa.
So you can say, I played piano with Alicia Keys.
Just not at the same time. Yeah. On the same instrument, but not at the same time.
Not at the same time. And when she was filming, Mos Def was on the production. So I went up to Def. I said, yo, Def, how you doing? He said, Globe, how you doing? I said, I'm good. He said, you on a production team? I said, no, I work here. He was like, what? He started with three walkie-talkies. Like,
it's fantastic.
So, I had a chance to wave at Alicia. I don't even know if she knew who I was.
But it doesn't matter. Wave at him.
It was cool, though.
You know, she is married to Swizz Beatz. She might have known.
She may have. I think Def might have went, you know, at one point said, yo, you know, Globe from Soul Sonic Force is here.
That's him over there.
He works here. You know, maybe he did get a chance to put it in an ear.
Maybe.
But, boy, that's another name that I don't think gets the credit that he deserves is Def.
Most Def.
Most Def is an amazingly talented man.
He's nice.
He's a hell of an actor, too. One of my favorite HBO movies of all time, Something the Lord Made.
Yes.
Mos Def stole that movie. Yes. And to steal a movie from the guy who played Snape in Harry Potter, that's saying something.
I like him in 16 Blocks with Bruce Willis. That's my move for Mos Def.
Yeah, man.
And Hitchhiker's Guide.
Yes.
But
and we still refer to him as that, by the way.
It's tough to say Yasiin Bey, I understand, but when I'm talking music, it's Mos Def. It's
because it was Mos Def was Mos Def when I saw him on Dave Chappelle's show.
Yeah.
Just completely tearing shit up in them end credits.
Destroying
that time.
That's my dude, man. That's what I'm talking about. It's like, will you love what you do?
Never work a day in your life.
Yeah, man. Very humble gentleman, man. Good guy. Good.
That's why we don't consider this show work. We love what we do. It's never work.
As long as it's still fun, we'll keep doing
it. When it becomes work, then the show goes in the archives. Yep. But right now, it's just two guys who talk hip hop
couple hours a week. Like we're sitting around his backyard, yeah, drinking some cold ones and looking out at the pool.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. It's the same.
Nice. You know, Sha-Rock had her event on the 3rd of June. The Sha-Rock which was day? Last, yeah, Saturday. It was really dope. And talking about work, I went out there just to chill and to listen to those old beats, man, and support Sha, but I had interviews the whole time. Yo, you know, and you wouldn't think that I didn't. I loved every second of it. Mm-hmm. You know, you want to take a picture? Take a picture. Mm-hmm. You want to ask me a question? Ask a question. You know, whatever. Blah, blah, blah. It was just, so it is fun, man. It's nice doing what you love to do. But that day, that was a work day. But it was cool, though, man. Sha worked really hard. Sha, jeez.
Yeah.
On behalf of Sha-Rock, man, that lady, I mean, back and forth, always flying back and forth, New York, text back.
Yeah. The hustle and grind never stops. Like, man. I can't even imagine. The hustle and grind must never stop for her.
Mm-mm. Whoa, man. She rocked the bells. And she found, like, when we talk, we spoke guests. We always talk no less than an hour. And we laugh. And we talk. And we laugh. She finds time for family and friends. She sacrifices for that. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's really dope, man. Yeah. That's an amazing woman, man. And I am blown away at her performance on the song, guys.
Yeah.
So were we. Really am, man.
So were we. I we shouldn't be just because we know she is the luminary icon for a reason. But that being said, every now and then you still got to let them know how you got that title. Mm-hmm. And she boom, sure as hell, yeah, let them know.
That's the key. That's, yep, the key, guys. That's why I do this also, because people, oh, what's so big about this hip hop thing? Oh, God, this whole hip hop thing. What are those guys doing now?
Mm-hmm. Well, sit down and put your seatbelts on. You're about to find out.
So, you know, I said, yo, man, every time I touch it, I'm going to show you why it is what it is.
Yeah.
And
the immortal,
you know,
the words of Kevin Hart, you're going to learn today. You're going to learn today.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Fun, man.
Good.
Fun.
All right.
All day.
Well, when you get new music, you know how to reach me. You make sure.
Yes.
I know about it, and I will put it out here, and we're gonna have to let you go because, you know, I got a 2-hour time limit for some of these radio stations I was telling you about.
Yeah.
And you know, the patrons will be happy; they'll get all the extra stuff. But please let everyone know where they can find you online, or performing, or appearing before we let you go.
Yes. Well, my Instagram ID is E-M-C-E-E. That's M-C. I couldn't use capital M-C, so I was able to get away with the E-M-C-E-E. They never gave me my blue check.
I heard you can buy one now.
I was going to say, for $8 a month, you can buy one on certain social media outlets whose names I don't want to mention, but their initials are the fucking Bird app.
So it's MC Globe, E-M-C-E-E-G-L-O-B-E.
You notice a new follower, it is because I am just following it right now. So there we go. No. See?
Thank you. And then there's John Miller on Facebook, which is my government name.
Which is how I found you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm going to publish my website, which is also going to be MC Globe soon. Nice. I'm just building it up nice and juicy so people have some to enjoy when they go there. And we are lining up shows Philadelphia in the coming months, Amsterdam in August. There's a big, huge concert taking place that I wish we could get on. Yankee Stadium,
yeah,
for the 50th anniversary of hip hop. And I would have loved to be a part of that.
Yeah.
LL publicly did say, when you guys go on my Instagram Pete L loves me. I spoke to him live on the air a couple of times, man. And he said, Globe, we got to get you on something. You know, we got to get you on something. So if it doesn't happen this year, maybe next year.
Yeah.
But he's doing his Force tour, which is going to be the plug that for him.
Yeah, we talked about that a couple of weeks ago, I think.
Yeah. And now coming Rock the Bells Festival.
Right, August
yes, August 5th.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. So I want to go hang out, you know, hang out backstage, maybe, you know, have some fun, you know, blah, 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 blah. But the park jams are taking place every Thursday in July in Crotona Park. I plan on popping up all 4 weeks of that just to, you know, hang out with the crew and everybody. But otherwise than that, re-release of three So Sonic Force songs or two So Sonic Force songs and Play That Beat. And this beat is from the Bronx, I think. Yeah, not Play That Beat, but this beat's from the Bronx on Media, Reservoir Media, right? Records. Otherwise than that, whatever pops up, you know. But basically, a whole lot of recording. And like I said, there'll be a second single coming out. And I'll probably drop about four more before Resume Records drops the second single. Second I'll one. Probably drop some more stuff on DistroKid, you know, just to.
Yeah.
Because I can.
Because you can. And, yeah. And because you know, we want it.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I'm getting. You know what? I'm getting used to. I'm spoiled, guys. I'm used to record company doing everything. I'm used to that. You know, I'm used to that. Like, I have a double album deal with Sony for licensing commercial songs. Mm-hmm. Okay, we finished one album. We got a song on The Simpsons. We got a couple of commercials out there, but they're doing all the hard work. You know, Tommy Boy did all the hard work.
Right.
Warner Brothers did all. Doing it yourself is work.
I understand.
You know, I miss that machine, man. But it's not going to stop me from putting out songs because there are hardcore listeners that really need to experience this hip hop, man.
Right.
Thank you, Bill and 2 Chainz and everybody else out there. Thank everybody out there listening that's taking their time out of their day to check this out. And, you know, it's coming, man. You know, some planet rock sounding shit and some hardcore boom bap sounding shit. Nice. So electro and boom bap too, man. I'm I'm having fun.
That's why they make those plates with the different sections on it, so you can get all that stuff at once.
Yeah.
It's barbecue season, so load my plate.
Yes,
man.
Yes.
Load my plate.
Yes. So, I appreciate you guys having me on.
Oh,
it's been a pleasure.
Anytime, we have an open chair for you. Anytime you want to come on.
Absolutely.
Oh, cool. Thank you. Let's see. And out there to the listeners, just like stay positive, stay strong, stay safe. Stay safe, positive, and strong. And watch the skies.
So before we let you go, what does GLOBE mean today, good sir? What does GLOBE stand for today?
Today, GLOBE would have to say, wow. Honestly, Google lots of better education.
There you have it.
Lots of better education.
You can't put this man on the spot. He'll knock you right off that spot. See,
you know, they're talking about our educational system. I don't like it, man. I don't like what they're saying.
Yeah.
They're saying like we as smart as we are. So Google lots of better education, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's all there.
Especially your hip hop education, and that's what we're here for.
Yes. Full circle. Like a globe.
Wow. All right.
Thank you, Globe.
You're welcome.
For hanging
welcome.
Out with us.
Thank you.
And we look forward to talking to you again.
Holler anytime you want.
All right, brother.
Peace. Peace.
Take care,
everybody. Thank you.
Ever been a better interview on this show than that?
No, sir.
I don't know if it's not the best, it's top three.
Yes.
What a fascinating individual.
Yes.
What a fountain of education and information. MC Globe. I guess we're going to take our final break of the day. We'll come back. I don't know how Bill Reed's lyrics is going to top what we just heard from Globe, but we're going to try.
It'll side by side. It will not.
Yes. Yes. It'll be a different section of that plate we were talking about. Episode 489. Come right on back for Bill Reed's lyrics.
I was sitting on the corner just a waste of my time. And when I realized there was the king of the rhyme, I got on.
This the king of hip hop himself, Grandmaster Melly Mel, voice of the legendary hip hop group, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. And this shout out goes to Jamie and Bill. And I love to endorse the show, and I wish everybody would tune in on Throwback Thursdays because they've been doing it for 5 years. So, Jamie and Bill, you keep up the good work. And this is Melly Mel, the king of hip hop. And I'm out. And wait a minute, let me not forget.
That street talk game. So if you ever let me make this clear, if you ever think that we're stepping out of here, you ever think you're getting up, down, around, or in, you better think again, my friend.
Funky hip hop.
But it starts with Bill.
I'm Bill S. Preston.
It's called reading. Top to bottom, left to right. Group words together as a sentence. Take Tylenol for any headaches. Might offer any cramps.
Most people probably don't listen to the lyrics, but they should.
Welcome to Bill Reed's Lyrics.
And welcome back to Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 489. It is indeed time for Bill Reed's Lyrics. And I'm quite sure it's not going to be Globe lyrics because Globe doesn't write stuff like this, I'm sure.
But you can do it for the Globe.
I could do it for the GLOBE. So would you be so kind, my friend, to shoot those lyrics my way?
I can do that. Blow.
I can do. Oh, well, of course it had to be this guy.
Well, of course.
Because.
You know what I didn't put in there? I didn't put the motherfucking piano in the board.
That makes sense. We're going to have to do that later. Well, it would make sense because you don't know how long you're going to need it for.
Fade it. Yeah.
Okay, so I guess we're doing King Neptune today.
We are. We're going to do verse one.
Which, if the news gets cut out, nobody's going to know what we're talking about. So we'll have to see.
I will do just that article if I have to. Mm-hmm.
Verse one, that's the part right after chorus because it's not marked verse one.
Yeah.
Does it start with you want? You?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
So with no type of ado.
I'm so scared. Sesame I don't know where this Street, is going.
Grover Stiley, whether nearer or further, we will cue the motherfucking piano.
You want freestyle? That's right. The style is free. Nickelbacks suck my dick and they girls drink my pee. I'm on some S&M shit you can't get with. Pull your panties down on stage and watch you sweat quick. Suckers back to pull. They style is transsexual. Lesbians dance with the funky heterosexual. You on the mic. And when you rhyme, I start to jerk off. Let my dog lick you, German Shepherd. Want to bust off. I tear your legs and spot MCs having anal sex. Step around like a Tampax and step up. Next, I enter New York. No problem with my dick out. California porno star, my ass you can lick out saying what? With sperm dripping down your partner's butt. I see MCs in my face with their ass up. Let me put my cape on, my rubber, and my mask up. Not no horrorcore shit. This is pornocore. I'm in the club naked, man. I'm the fucking pro. Nickelbacks can't wax no ass. Girls should let them know. Line two of the chorus is just the best. Nickelback's want it free. They dogs drink my piss. And that's just it. Over and over and over.
Yeah. Girls want to see.
Ain't nobody want to see dogs drinking piss.
Nope. That's an S, so, a yes. K, and a J.
Unless it's underwear pissy.
Well, yeah, that's a totally different thing.
That's my favorite name ever. That one ranks up there right with Shorty Shit Stain.
It does.
And I don't know why bodily functions make the best hip hop name.
I have no idea. But
I mean, what's going to be next? MC Diarrhea?
Probably. The reason I chose this song, because again, I do research. King Neptune. And then there's this lesbian's dance with the funky heterosexual.
Yes.
You've seen the mermaid.
Yes.
Parade.
Yes.
It fits.
Yeah, there was a whole lot of that on there.
So, since you have changed your hat from Bill to Phil.
I have. And again, it's not a shit hat. Hopefully, Mr. Cranky approves.
Would you be so kind as to take us home?
The Mr. Throwback Thursday show is an official affiliate of the world's strongest coffee, Deathwish Coffee. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or at deathwishcoffee.com. Use the code TBT. Save 12% off your order. Def Rugs, defrugs.com, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all at Def Rugs. Handmade, high quality hip hop themed rugs from the original rug E Fresh, Marshall Fox, and his business associate, the Green Eyed Bandit, mm-hmm. Eric Sermon. Go check out Def Rugs. Our good friend Heather Lent up in Schenectady, New York, is the proprietor of the Bittersweet Candy Company, where she makes candy and chocolate that is handmade, small batch, different, and
delicious.
Go check them out on Facebook or order at bittersweetcandy.com. Use our code throwback and save 10% off your order from bittersweetcandy.com. Melted Mics, MLTDMICS.com. Use our code MRTHROWBACKTHURSDAY to save 10% off of your order of hip hop themed t-shirts. The one you're wearing today, is that a Melted Mics t-shirt?
It is not. It is a Grandmaster Caz.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if he had one, because yes. I've been digging that t-shirt the whole show, yes, by the way.
GMC Entertainment. You know, I try my best to keep up with our classic artists and their ventures. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if they have merchandise out there, I like to support it. I will tell you that Dinko D's got some really cool stuff.
Which is why I had the Death Wish polo shirt on, as you can see today.
Dinko D has like skateboards. He has sneakers. And the reason I don't have Dinko D's stuff is I don't skate. I don't Not need anymore. More sneakers.
No.
But he's got some really stuff for those of you who do need that. Check him out.
But if you want some hip hop themed t-shirts, you can go to Melted Mics at MeltedMics.com. Use our code MRTHROWBACKTHURSDAY for 10% off. I actually just took my Fife Dog shirt out of the laundry yesterday. Nice. So that is back in the rotation for work. Etsy.com/shop/geeklikeyou, where the geeks shall inherit the earth.
Yes.
Hip hop and pop culture themed items from the sick, twisted mind of Mr. Throwback Thursday and a sick, twisted wife, Mrs. Throwback Thursday. Go to Etsy and search for Geek Like You, where the geek shall inherit the earth.
And maybe the Zelda bottle opener will end up in the shop.
That was cool. I dug that. Social media network time. Visit us at mrthrowbackthursday.com. mrthrowbackthursday.com is the home page for everything Mr. Throwback Thursday. You can click on the show notes for every episode. Mm-hmm. If we talked about it, go ahead and click on them and you can see more detail. Like I said, if you know, depending on what gets cut out of the show, there's some things that you can look at this week. Or you can leave us a voice message. Click that little microphone that says hit us up.
Yes.
And it'll allow you to leave us a voice message, which we will then play without listening to it first on the show. So if you really want to surprise us, go ahead and hit us up on MrThrowbackThursday.com. You can also follow us on our Twitter handles. Jamie is at @_MR_TBT. I am Bill_MR_TBT, which is also my Instagram handle. Mm-hmm. And Jamie's Instagram handle is @MR_Throwback Thursday. And Globe is @EMCEEGLOBE, because I just followed him right after our interview today.
Yes.
You can follow us on Facebook. Check out the pages. There is the Mr. Throwback Thursday page. There is the home of the TBT Posse page. Go check both of those out.
Let's do that.
You can also check us out every Thursday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern on Fresh Radio at itsfreshradio.com and the Fresh Radio app for your phones right after the All Request Thursday, which you can also be a part of by tweeting your requests to DJB at Real Fresh Radio on Twitter. Just don't ask for any Booyah Tribe. He won't play it.
He will not.
If you feel compelled to send us articles that you are interested in, you can send us email to MrThrowbackThursday@gmail.com. Shout outs to Gail Dunmire and Manny Baez and Sarah Henderson.
Wait, at Manny Baez at 37,000 feet.
At 37,000 feet. Yes, I'm so sorry. So I'll say it. Hi. At Manny Baez. There we go. Okay. Sarah Henderson, John Henderson, Hugo Gonzalez, Sanket Patel, Teresa Lynn Simple Luxuries at TeresaLynn's.com, Clay Arsenault, Jennifer Buchanan, the Shrieking Warrior, Jacob O'Neill, Jason Heath, Paulie Tibbert, Chris Kinsley, Jessica Walker, Shane Hatley, Ricky Schnarr, Kenneth Elsfelder, Mr. Cranky Pants himself, Brian Hollenbeck, Robert Jeffroy, Kate Harvey, Mark Merriam, Catherine Liska, and Ken Dwinell. They get mentioned because...
Or more.
Don't forget our friends, as always, the King of Sport with Brother Nate Milton and Chris Ely. Check out Anthony Imran and the Rug Boy over at the Jock and Nerd Podcast, our friend Talkin' Ty on her page, BrooklynTyNYC.com, and her show, the What's the Word Podcast with Brooklyn Ty. We mentioned B and Fresh Radio. We're also on Wild One Radio. Go to WildOneRadio.com. We are on there Fridays or Thursday, 7 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and all throughout the weekend. Go check them out and find out when we are available in your area. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, review, all of that good stuff. Find us, share the good word, especially about this wonderful interview we had this week. Take good care of yourselves and each other. Wash your hands.
Wash your butt.
And until next time, keep it classic. And always remember,
new school stale, old school fresh.